Early forays into the archive led me to discover writings and speeches by Guy Debara, texts that were self-critical and revelatory, and helped me unearth the ideas of an architect from 50 years ago. Especially significant were his musings that examined his own motivations for making unusual transitions within and outside the profession. In his own words then, quote, "The delivery of a fine product of a well-designed building is a very chancy affair. The hit and miss character of this endeavor is what has led me to stray from the undeniable pleasures of active building design to the fields of education and management in search of ways to predictable quality," end quote. This is an excerpt from a convocation address to the engineering faculty at Concordia in 1977. But to really understand the practical implications of these words, I had to burrow deeper into the archive in search of a fine product, an attempt at predictable quality, capable of influencing a reputed architect, a partner at ARCOP, one of Canada's top firms, to leave active building practice. Laying out drawings of some of Debra's most acclaimed projects side by side, including the Massey Award-winning St. Gerard Majella Church, the iconic Place des Arts building, and the Expo theme pavilion of Man the Producer, I was struck by the technological sophistication of the pavilion. All the projects were designed in the early to mid-1960s, Montreal's golden years, yet the drawings of the pavilion seemed complex and futuristic, employing extraordinary tools, technologies, and geometries. Intrigued, I set out to find out more about this potentially fine product, and I was rewarded with an interesting account of a project, an architect, and a tumultuous time for the profession of architecture. Montreal of the 60s, under the leadership of Mayor Jean Drapeau, provided a fertile environment, rich in commissions and creative liberties for the city's architects. The local firm of Affleck Debara, Dimakopoulos Levinsoul-Sees, later ARCOP, enjoyed many of these grand commissions. Notable among them, those of Place Ville-Marie, Place des Arts, and finally the theme pavilions for the World Expo in 1967. Within this climate of unlimited possibilities, the original plan for the fair envisioned an exceptional system by which all exhibitions would be combined within a series of pavilions. The pavilions would be integrated within a mechanized circulation system with clusters of smaller pavilions around them. But government bureaucracy and conservatism prevailed over experimentation, and the expo officials went ahead with the traditional fair planning of distinct national or industrial pavilions. But the theme pavilions, specifically Man the Producer, retained the concept of a structure that could contract and expand and was integrated within the transportation system. Debara described it as a pilot project to structure new cities. Challenged by a brief that required a structure that was flexible in terms of space, providing a range of volumes, and also in terms of time, allowing for changes well into the working drawing stage and even post-construction, the architects and engineers opted for a modular planning unit that could be adjusted to suit exhibition requirements. The truncated tetrahedron was arrived at as one of the simplest geometries other than a rectangular block, which when nested fills a space between two parallel planes. The volumes and forms of the pavilion were created by the natural tendency of these truncated tetrahedrons to assimilate themselves into larger versions of the same geometry. Consequently, the Man the Producer Pavilion was conceived as an architectural system that forms spaces. The building was never imagined formally. The design emphasis was on the structure, the system, and the human experience. The design was arrived at as a system that could respond to a flexible program, while at the same time ensuring high standards of spatial experience, the so-called predictable quality that Debra valued. Sketches and studies of the pavilion ventured in parallel into geometric analysis, structural responses, and spatial experience of the building. The external elevation was determined by these parameters and not the reverse. In spite of its systematic design that attempted to correspond to structural and programmatic flexibility while ensuring controlled outcomes, the pavilion was not immune to uncontrollable external influences. This became evident with the discovery of Debra's unpublished autobiography, titled Three Views of Architecture, A Troubled Profession, written in the 1990s. Eagerly I looked for his account of the theme pavilion and found a chronicle that was marked by feelings of both accomplishment and frustration. According to Debara, issues of control began to manifest themselves fairly early in the design. Firstly, the expo construction schedule led to limited collaboration with the exhibition designers, leaving architects with very little information about the space and load requirements. Secondly, in a space structure like the pavilion, control over fabrication was vital for the architect. Yet, the Canadian Corporation waived the fabricator's requirement to provide shop drawings. And without the architect's control, the production resulted in unanticipated changes in detail and appearance of the structure. Thirdly, the fabrication proceeded slowly, resulting in delays that affected the choice of cladding. This led to the architects abandoning the idea of an inflatable colored plastic skin that would expose the structure, in favor of plywood cladding that got the space ready in time for the fair. The man the producer pavilion was, as Debara describes, an attempt at, quote, exploring the ability to correspond to a variable program by an extensible transformable structure, creating spaces always readable and sometimes beautiful. Yet, to the consternation of Debara as the ARCOP partner in charge of the project, most criticism of the building focused on its aesthetic and formal qualities, such as Progressive Architecture magazine denouncing it as heavy, cumbersome, and inefficient, and still others making unfavorable comparisons to the Eiffel Tower. Debara dismissed these comments as critics who couldn't read a building section, but in an in-depth article in Architecture Canada, Guntis Plessens, the job captain for the project, explained the poor reception in the architectural press as arising from a limited understanding of the evolution of the structure. Still, the pavilion did not go unappreciated by critics. Rainer Banham, in his account of Expo 67, published in New Society and later as part of his book Mega Structures, paid tribute to Man the Producer. His initial commendations of the building acknowledged the successful use of tetrahedral geometry throughout the structure and its consistency in spite of external parameters like fire safety requirements and uncooperative exhibition designers. Yet, paradoxically, Banham's further praise of the pavilion plays into this narrative of unpredictable outcomes. His chief praises were attributed to what he called its accidental success, its experiential qualities that he interpreted as being unintentional. Ironically, Banham celebrated the architect's lack of control. He highlighted the redundancies of space use that created a freedom of routes and gave the users an unexpected amount of control and the extraordinary power to design their own experience. Echoing the title, exhibit titled Man in Control? That questioned man's ability to harness technology, the pavilion grappled with an appropriate technological response to the requirement of a flexible program. Notwithstanding the perceived failure or success of this experiment, the issue of predictable quality in building continued to stimulate Debara in his future career. By the late 60s, there was a slump in construction post-Expo 67, and Debara took this opportunity to pursue his elusive ideal of predictable quality in the building industry, and his personal agenda to better harness the information explosion that had stumped architects in the post-war generation. He accepted the post of Dean of University of Montreal's Architecture Department in 1968, leaving active design practice and ARCOP for good. As an educator, he was better poised to examine and promote knowledge management in the industry. Diagnosing the problems within the architectural profession as a delayed response to the application of emerging science and technologies, Debara visualized the university model of comprising of three distinct divisions, basic, applied, and interdisciplinary branches. Through collaborations between these three branches, Debara's proposal and subsequent restructuring of the architecture department imagined a university model that would continually respond to changes in technology. Debara continued to venture off the beaten path for architects, and offered to serve as Assistant Deputy Minister of Design drew him away from education into the central government in Ottawa, still harboring ideas about the need for better knowledge management in the industry. Out of these ideas grew the design for the construction information system. a computer-supported system that would be a virtual database on products and materials for the construction industry. In an exclusive interview with Heavy Construction News in 1971, Debra described the system as a shrapnel burst of information on an industry that traditionally suffered from a lack of communication. Here was another attempt at using technology to counter problems within the construction industry, caused by deficiencies in collaboration and shared research. What is interesting about this image is the contrasting imagery of the omnipotent architectural expert against the letterhead of Heavy Construction. But this is precisely the gap that Debra worked to fill. He recognized the construction industry as a working whole, and the key to structuring new, better cities would be for different tiers of the industry and its experts to combine their knowledge and collaborate. This concept of groupthink and interdisciplinary collaboration as a counter to the information anxiety that plagued architects in the 60s and 70s, and even to some extent today, is worth examining. The Man, the Producer Pavilion, as we saw earlier, was not completely understood by critics. So my contribution to the archive is an effort to facilitate understanding of the pavilion. It was truly a remarkable structure, ahead of its time and an experiment in conceptualizing architecture as a system of spaces and structures. The do-it-yourself paper model mirrors this intention. The emphasis is on its building and assembly, an aesthetic appreciation of the parts and not the whole. Using archival drawings to study the building with a view to first recreating and then deconstructing it was an intimate encounter with the archive that I hope to share with the model maker. Through the making of this object, the model maker also becomes aware of the parameters of working with this tetrahedral geometry, both the freedoms and constraints it offers. The resulting form is a product determined by this tactile exploration, admired only as a consequence of the individual's agency and an understanding of its workings, as a mechanic might admire an engine. Moving now from a temporary project to an unbuilt one, Ian will now introduce a second case study, a project by Victor Proust.